All right, I think we're gonna get started. Thank you everybody for joining us today for this amazing presentation by Ellen Sue, artistic recruiter from Titmouse. We're so excited to have you today, Ellen, and thank you so much for joining us. I'm putting Ellen's bio in the chat for everyone to take a look at when they have, but wanted to jump in to the presentation so that we could leave some time for Q&A at the end. So at this point, I'm gonna turn it over to Ellen. I did want to let everyone know we are recording today's session in case anyone that wanted to attend couldn't. And also, if you have questions, please feel free to put them in the chat. You can send them to me directly, or you can send them to everyone. We're going to be monitoring the chat so that we can ask those questions of Ellen after she's done with her presentation. So Ellen, take it away.
Awesome. All right. Thank you. Thank you guys for having me. And hi, Betsy.
hi, Ellen. Thanks for coming.
Yes, yes. All right. I'm going to screen share. I'm going to share sound. Okay. Are you seeing the We Make Cartoon slide?
Yes,
we're good.
Awesome. Cool. Well, hi, everybody. My name is Ellen Sue. I am the artistic recruiter from Titmouse. And if you're not aware of Titmouse, we are an animation production company and we make cartoons. Here's a look at our reel.
Been the missing element in everything that we've attempted so far.
Success.
Shush it down.
Barbara, what are you doing with my last good banana?
Dr. Oz says they need to learn.
No, he doesn't need to know anything.
Actually,
please, the next time you think you need to know something, Andrew, shut your face. Now give me the banana. Ah, Jesus, it tastes like condoms.
Chirp.
Right. So we do a lot of different things. Oh my goodness. How do I get out of here? At Titmouse makes animation from pre-K all the way to adult comedy, and everything in between. So we are quite unique, I think, in the, studios, in America, where it's just, there's no set style. We do a little bit of everything. And so before we get into everything, I do want everyone to take all the advice I'm about to give with a grain of salt, because, anybody who gives you advice is going to be giving you advice from their perspective, from their experiences, and that might not be relevant by the time you're going through that, experience, or you're not the same person, so it might not work out the same way for you compared to how it did for that person that's giving you the advice. So yeah, think critically and see, you know, just make decisions based off your own research. But okay, what do I need to do to get a job in animation? Well, firstly, animation is a skill-based industry, and maybe you've seen this meme floating around about people wanting to get jobs, but employers like, you need experience, but I need a job to get experience, then work. All right, well, here's the thing, which is the pro of the animation industry is that most of the time, unless we're hiring for like a director or supervisor, skilled relevant artwork can equal work experience. So when we're saying 3 years of work experience, we job postings could also mean or portfolio of relevant skill level. And what that means is, for example, somebody that's worked on Big Mouth for 5 years might not be a good fit for like Castlevania. So they might not have the skilled work relevant to the style of Castlevania. So just that's something to keep in mind. Your portfolio is the most important thing and your artwork is the most important thing. So checklist, making sure that you have an easy access online portfolio with relevant examples of artwork. It doesn't matter the platform. You have your email address on whatever platform you choose in a copy and pasteable format. Don't make us use contact forms. And resume is not as important for artistic roles, but it is a must for production roles. If you're applying for a PA or a production coordinator, that's something you have to have. For the love of all things animated, just a friendly reminder to include your email. Doesn't matter what year it is, how many times I've given this presentation, somebody's going to forget their email, so just double check. If you're using Twitter as your main portfolio, write in the bio. If you're using Instagram, bio, Behance. Right under the name actually is a great place for it. Tumblr, you can also use Tumblr as a portfolio. Bio, if you have a website, it's really nice to just have it right under your name in the header so that no matter what page I go to, it's still right there for me to copy and paste. And then if you have a video reel, make sure that yes, it's in the title card, but copy and paste the format in the description, because if I'm transcribing and I'm accidentally writing your email wrong and that email bounces, that time period could be like, oh, somebody else responded and I'm going with them, right? So don't let that happen. Copy and paste is very important to avoid those mishaps. All right, keywords, easy access. You want us to be able to easily see your work and easy to contact you. So whenever you're setting up your portfolio, whatever it is, just keep this in mind. This is a mantra. This is the golden rule. You don't want a lack of access to your work to be the reason you don't get the job. And lack of access could be like, oh, it's a really weird format and I clicked the enter button, then couldn't find the like all the little like tiny little buttons to go to your work. Or it's in so many different pages that like I've seen one page, seen the second page, didn't click the third page. And that might've been the thing that I needed to see to hire you, right? So just easy formatting. And we'll get into that in a little bit. I had that happen to me where I made a really fancy website with lots of sliding pages and moving things. And I didn't realize that my interviewer at Google wasn't seeing my actual work and didn't get the job until, you know, like didn't realize it until it was too late and didn't get the job. So you're not being hired for a web designer position. It's artwork. And then thinking about spam filters, this is only for Titmouse, I think, or any studio that uses a not like .com email. I feel like Hotmail and Yahoo likes to kick the .net emails to the spam filter. So if you're not using Gmail, I mean, even if you are using Gmail, just in case, you can whitelist at titmouse.net, just in case. All right, how do I format my portfolio for easy access? Thinking about the answer to can you do XYZ is all on the first page we see. Whether your main passion is character, props, animation, whatever it is. I'm not even saying scrolly. I'm saying like right where we land. Can you answer this question? And so one of my favorite examples is Micah Scherf. because I feel like everything relevant to can this person design characters is right there in this section. I don't even need to scroll. I'm like, yes, relevant artwork to the 2D animation character design position. And that is the character turntable, so a turnaround. So making sure that if you want to design for 2D animation, you have a character turn and it's cleaned up, because in 2D animation, like, nobody else is going to clean that up for you, right? So clean lines, good line weight, depending on the style that you're going for. And then she's got special poses, which is great. She's got some interesting explorations for non-human characters, which is awesome. There's this assignment called the character redress, which is a junior assignment, or even assistant as character assignment. So what you can do is get an existing character from an existing show and design new outfits for them, or hairstyles or makeup, you know. So that is another assignment that you could do to build up your character design portfolio. And then beyond this, also notice that none of these thumbnails are cropped off. And so that's great. I get the full picture. And then additional things as I scroll down, it's like, oh, here's something in a different style. Here's something with more anatomy. Here's her foundation anatomy drawing. So I can see that skill set as well. And that's all great. All of it, one page curated. I don't have to scroll too much. There's not too much work for me to get through, which is great. And she has additional interests that is clearly labeled. So here's her prop and design work. Great. Here's some of her story work. I think there's an NDA section. Great. So yes, very clear, all on that front page. Here's an example of a great, very talented illustrator. And I know a lot of your illustrators as well. And when I present this portfolio to my higher ups, the questions that come back is, oh, he's just an illustrator. He's not designing for animation. Can he even design for animation? They're very busy. They might not even notice this animation tab, and they're just going to move on. If I'm not in the room with these people, I can't direct them to, wait, no, look at this page, right? They might just take a glance, move on, because they're very busy. So help me help you by making it easy for me to sell you to the team. So once we get to the animation page too, notice that things are cropped off and these images are very wide. So some of his really fun designs are cropped off. Maybe what's in the middle that is showing up in the thumbnail isn't the most appealing. It's showing less work. And again, hidden some of his work. So thinking about that when you're setting up your portfolio is also important, trying not to crop off any thumbnails. I've seen other websites where it's cropped, like it's a really long character design and it's cropped like just in the middle of the body, which doesn't show me, you know, the full design. So thinking about that as well. Here's an example. She's since updated her portfolio, but Sammy is somebody that's worked in the industry before, and she's worked on lots of productions, actually. Unfortunately, she's worked on a lot of adult comedy productions. So as you can see, there's some Rick and Morty character turns. There's some from like, I forget, but it's a lot. She had a lot of adult comedy work. She was applying for something that was more like realistic superhero Marvel character styles. And I scrolled for a very long time and there was so much stuff. It was all professional stuff, but it wasn't relevant to the Marvel style. Mm-hmm. And I moved on. Sammy thankfully knew somebody on the production, shared some work with them, and they were able to hire her. And I found out that her Marvel stuff was all the way at the bottom. And she wasn't curating her website. So she has since updated this to a broader view. And I don't have to scroll too far before I get to the Marvel relevant stuff. So that's something to think about, curating your website. If the things you're showing are redundant, maybe think about just doing your best of. That's what your portfolio is for, your best of.
Cool.
And again, best of, like, I really like this grid format because immediately you do see a sprinkling of a variety of works in this 9 grid. Sometimes, you know, what you think is the best option and the biggest image up top maybe turns the recruiter off and they move on. So that's something to keep in mind. If you have multiple options, they could be, you know, increasing the one that they're drawn to. So if you're into prop design, something to keep in mind too is vehicles are something good to have. I don't know if you need too many of them, but being able to do like the hard surface structural props is great. Similar to characters, there's some prop turnarounds. Prop designs, if you can do like different styles. So a lot of 2D animation is lined artwork, but there's also vector artwork. So if you have that, great to showcase it. A fun assignment that you could do working with professional materials is finding storyboards from shows you love and designing a hero prop from it. Here's an example of the assignment from a prop designer, Kyle Bowman. Sometimes I get asked for prop designers with graphic design sensibilities, and that means any kind of typography or packaging design. So here's some billboards. Here's like the side of a truck, candy boxes, you know, any kind of that typography stuff. Prop design, if you have that sensibility, it's great to showcase it. Before we get too far, I do want to talk about the structure of an animation team. And obviously this is exaggerated for, you know, this purpose, but VizDev, character design, prop design, there's not that many roles for a production. So like, usually I'm looking at the structure, it's like 2 character designers, and then maybe 6 people in backgrounds. 1 colorist, maybe 2. And then we've got like 6 to 10 storyboard artists, lots of animators if we are doing animation in-house, and compositors, editors. So that is to say that it's very competitive in character design. I don't want to dissuade you because I also have trouble finding character designers that can do character turnarounds and have a great handling on anatomy. I suspect it's like, oh, animation is hard, storyboards is hard, perspective and backgrounds is hard, and people are like, character design, I can do that. So like lots of people say they want to do character design. And it's really hard to like build anatomy correctly. So the sweet spot is if you have solid understanding of anatomy, you're able to do those character turnarounds, and I think finding work won't be too hard for you. All right, so let's talk about backgrounds. Luckily for people, backgrounds is split into 2 categories, background design and layout, and background painting. The difference between design and layout is like, depending on the studio, they might use it interchangeably. Technically, I believe background design is pre-production phase. So you're doing like the key single design of a main location, and then layout is like, okay, now let's design all the different like angles and, you know, down camera, up camera, here's it from a 180 degree perspective, whatever, of that main design that happened in production. So layout is like a production role, design is pre-production role. But the thing that's most important is you don't need to know color. You don't have to have great color theory to be a great background designer. The most important thing is perspective. And I would say at this point, a lot of productions are using Blender or some 3D software to help them with perspective. Setting up your grids, perspective grids, is time consuming and hard and takes a long time, even for the pros. So yeah, even the hard part of background design can now be cheated with 3D software, which is free. So something to keep in mind if you're interested in background design. The other thing is, can you use depths, you know, tones to create that nice feeling of the environment, to clarify what's happening in the environment? And then can you do clean line art as well as vector line art? I would focus on the clean line art first. That's really, I feel like, the majority of work before you dip your toe into, you know, vector unlined. Can you design sets that are believable? This is the set dressing aspect of background design. You know, you look at a room and you're like, yes, this is a hat maker's workshop. And that's because of the props that they decided to put into this room, right? Does it look livable? Does it look nicely designed or appropriate to the story? Things to keep in mind. And then, of course, if you have that ability to use 3D, Blender, Maya, SketchUp, definitely showcase that process of using it and then the final design. It's a very great skill to have and a desirable skill to have as a background designer. Background paint. Do you have a good sense of color and can you create multiple lighting scenarios for one background, night, day, sunset? Maybe you can paint in different styles. You don't have to do it all. I would just say focus on one, get real good at it before you start branching out. And if you're looking for practice assignments, my recommendation to you is to work off of professional artwork. I've actually started a thread recently about like asking professionals like, hey, do you have some like black and white line arts that people interested in background paint can use? What you want to look for is backgrounds that the perspective is impeccable. The line art is impeccable if it is lined. And like, you know, we're not being distracted by, oh, the perspective of that chair is off, or like, oh, that toothpaste doesn't really look like it's actually sitting on the countertop. You don't want us to be distracted by things that you don't have control over, right? So make sure you're working off of the perfect perspective background design so that we're only judging you by your colors and your painting quality. Okay. Color stylist is something else for people with great color theory, likes really coloring things and, you know, painting stuff. So essentially you're given like characters or props, sometimes environments too, and to just please color these characters relevant to the scene that they'll be in. Design the, if there's shadows, please design the shadow shapes accordingly. And Victoria Thornberry has some great samples. A lot of adult animation actually likes to, okay, episodic moves really quickly. So we try to cut down on steps as much as possible. So sometimes we have colorists working in Flash so that they're actually already filling out those colors in the rigs that the animators will then use. Sometimes they'll also color backgrounds in Flash. So if you know how to use Flash, you know how to color and design in Flash, that is something great that you should definitely be advertising on your website and resume. So this is an example of how they do that. Here's another example that you could utilize if you do different styles. So choose a thumbnail, your best of thumbnail. Sometimes, you know, if you have that work experience, or you can be like personal projects based off of the regular show, or, you know, personal projects based off Big Mouth. You could do that because recruiters will also be like, be told, hey, I need a background designer that can do Big Mouth stuff, you know? So like that might be something worth searching as we're finding artists. Storyboards. All right. If you're interested in storyboards, here's one of my favorite storyboard portfolio samples. Take it or leave it on this section. You know, I'd rather just see the work first, but click through boards is the most important thing. And why? Because we want to see everything play out. We can tell like the continuity of a story. We can get a sense of like, if you're using depth of field accurately, you know, depending on like what kind of show style it is. Once we can see all of that and you're like, yes, you understand all the foundational things you need for storytelling and storyboarding, I like to have this like big, you know, pages so I could just get through the rest of the story quickly. And then in here, you can also see, oh, a variety of like close-ups and wides and yada, yada. So that's great. And I love that she showcases it, but like the most important thing is click through boards. She uses speaker deck. Another thing is when you're uploading images to click through boards, make sure you shrink them down so that they're just like, I don't know, 500, 600. you know, pixels wide. Sometimes we get huge 3000 pixels images and it lags. So like every time I try to like click to the next board, it is black and then it loads. And then that again ruins the effect of like watching everything play out, you know? So making sure that the sizes are small. And then if you have like, oh, you do some other things, there's development sketches, maybe character designs attached to the story, some thumbnail, you know, thinking, ideation that you want to attach. It's great that you have the slideshow function beneath it to just have it all together. I don't have to click to another page, you know, it's great. Again, you don't have to have every single story to be a monster, you know, 90 page, whatever. You should be able to tell great stories in like 4 to 48 frames. And that's great because she showcases those as well. And it's great energy and, you know, just thoughts. And it's a story that I, you know, can relate to. Every great storyboard artist I know will tell tiny stories and practice that every single day. So it's great to have a sprinkling of both. And you should be doing additional suggestions is if you have, you know, different genres, like I want to do action and I want to do comedy, you know, it's great to tag it as well and label it in some ways. People ask, should I have animatics? And I would say only include animatics if you have great timing. And if you have like sound effects and audio and stuff like that, because I've watched animatics that were poorly timed and it like stays on one frame for like 30 seconds and I just couldn't get through it, I moved on. So only do it if it's well timed. On the subject of animatics, did you know there's a whole career in editing? You as an animatic editor have a lot of control over story, timing, you know, the structure of something. So if you love story, but you're not necessarily like a great storyboard artist or an animator, that's something to consider. You have to learn Premiere. You'll have to learn, you know, the foundations of film, filmmaking, visual storytelling, all that stuff. But if you can cut up boards, you know, do some basic animations like, oh, well, this car drives across the screen. Something to look into. Animatic editor will also need to be able to do scratch sound design. So adding like, here's an explosion, here's lightning or thunder crashing, you know, they'll have to do that. And sometimes they'll have to record scratch dialogue with appropriate performance for the story. So that's something to keep in mind too, you know, like just, you have everything you need, like phone, record some scratch dialogue, edit it all in Premiere. Done, you know, so there's a lot of free resources online to get sounds effects, YouTube, freesound.org. I'm sure there's way more, but if you want animatic samples, team up with a good storyboard artist. And again, work with the best material possible. So we're not judging you off somebody else's mistakes. All right, here's an example of animatics. Let them control me when they criticize me. I don't listen, they don't realize I like to be different. All they do is lie, 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 lie. Talking in my ear, but I do not want to hear. I be like, lie, 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 lie. Get up on my face, give me space, give me space. All right. Yeah, timing is pretty much all there. That was a music video. Here is an example of story-driven stuff.
This is known as the heliocentric theory. Helio means sun in Greek. The sun is the center of everything in the solar system.
Heliocentric. I love that word. Heliocentric.
Heliocentric.
I love the way it sounds. Have you heard?
Yeah. Essentially, you see the audio, the scratch, you've got that music if necessary. Scratch music can also really help set the tone of animatics. So it doesn't have to be final music. And there's some like camera moves, you know, that's in there. All right. Animation reel. Any video reel to for that fact, for that matter. It all starts with an title card. This is what a title card is. It generally has your name in it, and it says what you do. So you could have an animation reel, an animatic reel, like a, if we're going into 3D, you know, like a modeling reel, stuff like that. Generally has a year, so people know when it, how recent the work is. Keep your title card short. Sometimes people have really long title cards, and I just skip ahead. That's not what we're there for, you know? And then your best shot up at the front. It should generally be like a completed shot, like a fully cleaned up, colored animated shot. And yeah, sometimes I see reels where the best work is at the back of the reel, and like they're really old, not great work is at the front, which is awful because I've dismissed people for that. And then, yeah, so best work, front. And then quality over quantity. Again, you'll be judged by your weakest projects. You are not in the room with the person, you know, you're not there to explain, oh, that was done like 5 years ago. You're not there to explain, oh, I just, you know, wanted to fill in the space, so I just threw it in there. Like, don't do that. Don't feel the need to fill in the time of anything. Like, we've hired people because they had one or two great projects and that was all they had on their website, right? So quality over quantity. I myself and lots of other people I know that have watched reels, we watch the first shot, we skip to the middle, we skip to the end, and that's how we do it. And so again, start with the best and strong, and then only best stuff in the middle, like, yeah. For a lot of junior animators, one thing too is label your shots. You know, if you can use different animation softwares, it's great to say what you did in what. So TV Paint, Flash, or Adobe Animate, or Toon Boom, let us know. And also let us know what you did, whether it's everything, or if you only did the cleanup, or, you know, stuff like that. I see a lot of junior animation reels only have rough animation. None of it is completed. And that is terrible because as a junior animator, you're likely only being hired to clean up animation. So you want to be able to showcase that you can draw clean, connected line art. My recommendation there, if you're starting out and your animation skills aren't that strong yet, work again off of professional work, find some rough animation clips that, you know, professionals are posting online, ask them for permission. Hey, can I clean this up for practice so that you have, you're working with the best material. And yeah, clearly labeling what you did out of that shot. Compositing, if you like making the final beautiful picture, if you love color adjustment, color, you know, finagling, putting those final touches on an image to make it all pretty, maybe compositing is for you. Here's some examples of a great reel. So this person is showing us what they did. Here's the raw animation they're given and all the little things they did to bring it all together. That can include adding shadow, color adjustments, adding vignettes. It can include some animation, you know, these graphics and stars and twinkles that are being added. Camera moves happen in compositing. So can you set up like parallax and 3D scenes with flat 2D images, effects and stuff like that. Yes, and then as you get more advanced, actually, I see AE compositors being asked to find AE compositors that can like do little effects like the action lines. Just effects animation. So something to think about. Okay, what am I doing? All right, GIFs, animation. If you're in the business of making things move and you've got a website, I would suggest making GIFs. As I said, me and many others skip through reels. And so we might skip through a shot that's really cool. But if you have this wall of GIFs that's on your website, then you're forcing people to just immediately see everything you've done, right? So something to consider, easygifs.com has made making GIFs very, very easy. Photoshop is terrible at making GIFs, but you can do everything on easygifs.com, compress, cut down frame rates, you know, all that. Just upload an MP4 or MOV. It's great. All right, production assistants. We get a lot of questions about like, okay, well, I feel like a lot of people or teachers or whatever are pushing people to find production assistant roles. And I would just like to reiterate that you don't need to be a PA first before you get into a different like design or storyboard role. There are actually producers out there who are like, I don't want somebody who wants to be an artist. I want somebody actually interested in production. So that's not to say I don't apply for it, because there are people like, oh, we want somebody who knows design to help be the PA for the design department, right? My suggestion is, if you're applying for a PA, really read the job description and really apply with a resume that's catered to the position, because what is a PA going to be doing? They're going to be managing schedules and asset lists. They're going to be taking notes at every meeting. They're going to be in charge of filing, renaming files, organization, making sure everything's in the right folder, right? So if you're applying to some PA position, make sure your resume reflects those things. If you're writing a resume that has none of that in it, you're likely not going to be hired. So again, thinking about what you're being hired for and making sure that you're showing the studio that you're paying attention and you're taking this job seriously, because producers have been burned by like people that, oh, got the job and then neglected their PA duties to make friends with artists, right? So don't be that person. Yeah, and you can find that kind of experience anywhere, you know, like I've seen like people like, oh yeah, I worked a desk job and I had to organize some files. Great, relevant experience for the PA position. So find that relevant experience wherever you can. And then the cover letter is important because you want to try to talk about yourself and your personality and how you are there to help make a producer's life easier. So thinking about that. All right. Lots of information there. Now let's talk about how you're going to reach out. You have your easy access portfolio, your email address. How can you get a studio to notice you? And let me introduce you to... the Attention Grabber 9000 trademarked. What is the Attention Grabber? It's an unobtrusive way to force a hiring manager to immediately see carefully curated samples of your work, 1 to 4 images at most. And the goal is to entice them to spend a few more minutes with your message or with your portfolio. Opportunities come in many different places, so knowing where to place this Attention Grabber is key. So let's talk about the email outreach. Don't send emails like this. This has nothing that will like encourage me or like make me excited about, like, what am I going to do? Google you, like spend time trying to track you down and find your work. Like, don't do that. And then I also receive a lot of messages like this on LinkedIn or Twitter, like asking for permission. Can I send you my portfolio? Just send it. Just send it. Because what if I don't respond? Are you going to be in that weird limbo of like, I'm not allowed, you know, like, so just send it. We get a lot of messages from people that are not serious about animation or art, you know, so like having that portfolio, having that work to share with us shows us, you know, you're serious, and it might show us like you've got potential and we want to like, you know, reach out and talk to you. So attention grabbing, you know, you get one chance, one glance to catch our attention. Make sure everything's ready to go in your one message or page or video. And I'm not saying it's the one chance for the rest of your life, but at the off chance that we do open your message, you know, make sure everything's ready to go. So let me introduce you to Drew Shields, the OG Attention Grabber. This was back when I was working at Nathan Love. He reached out to our general jobs at nathanlove.com email. And I had no intention of hiring Mr. Drew Shields. I just wanted to get rid of the unread notification in my inbox. So I opened his email and then I saw this GIF and I was like, oh, that GIF is pretty darn cool. So even though I was really, really busy, I got distracted by his work and started looking through his portfolio. Unfortunately, I didn't have work for him at the moment, so I couldn't, you know, offer him anything, but I was like, yes, Drew, this is great. Please keep in touch. We don't have anything for you at the moment. Drew responded 6 months later. I mean, like, yeah, he was like, thank you. Great. He reached out again 6 months later, sent a new GIF. I'm like, ah, oh, what a treat to open this in the middle of my day. This is exciting. I'm looking through his work. I'm checking out his new projects. Again, still didn't have work for him, unfortunately. And then a year later, he emailed us a third time. This time he had done a different project. It was something he had done in 2D animation. So everything thus far was 3D. Then he did it in 2D. He had changed his subject line to AE Animator Compositor, available for freelance. And lo and behold, at that time, my go-to AE Compositor was unavailable. And I've been wanting to give Drew Shields a job for a year now. I'm like, yes, you're the one. Finally, wonderful. I'm not even going to look elsewhere. Let's work together. So that is the kind of attention grabber you want. A lot of, you know, getting your first gig is about luck and timing. Luckily for you guys, there's so much animation happening right now. I would imagine that as long as you're outreaching to many, many different places, I don't think it's going to be that hard. Other things to keep in mind, why is this email great? The subject line includes the position you want so that it's easily searchable later. The cover letter, just a couple of sentences, you know, talking about any previous experience you might have, link to the portfolio, very important, and the attention grabber, very important. Just don't attach your entire portfolio unless it's like a PDF. Why is the subject line important? Because you want to think about it as easily searchable words. I might not have work for a character designer when you email me, but maybe 3 months later I do. And maybe I remember the GIF you sent me. I'm like, okay, I know they said character designer in the subject line roughly around this time. I'm going to search character designer in my inbox. If it's not in the subject line, your thing might not show up. So just remembering that, remembering to make it easy for people to find your stuff again. And again, you can also use things like shared and graduate, CCS graduate, something you know, that stands out that's relevant to animation. Twitter, I have posted this thread and some other future threads where I'm like, post your portfolio down in the comments. This is a fantastic opportunity to not only get my eyes on your work, but hiring managers or recruiters from other studios that are snooping on my profile. And I've been told by my boss to snoop on other studios' threads. Other producers have admitted they've snooped on my threads. So if you see an opportunity like this, make sure you utilize it to the best of your ability. Utilize portfolio day hashtags for the ladies in here, visible women hashtags. People are looking at them. Here's an example of people that are not using attention grabbers. Very easy to scroll past these if there's like a billion of them. Here are the people that did utilize the attention grabbers. You can upload 4 images on Twitter, create this beautiful little showcase. Make sure you include your email, make sure you include your full website and what you are doing. I think some of these people also like didn't say what they did too, right? So that's important. Even hashtag that, hashtag character design, hashtag background design, make sure you're utilizing that so you are searchable, findable by us. This person created this little video, which is great. It's like a little hack where she scaled down 4 different projects that she did and then rendered out a single video. So if you do animation, here's another great example of how to do like a showcase, a grid immediately. If you have a website, make sure that you go into your settings, update a social image so that you include something so that when you're sharing on Twitter or social media platforms that an image shows up when you're sharing the link. So like this person did it and that's great. If you don't do it, this is what happens when you share it on Twitter. So sad face. All right, website job applications. We use a platform called Lever. So if you like click on apply job on our titmouse.net website, it'll lead you to something that's like lever.titmouse, whatever. Other studios use this as well. I think Bento Box uses it. And here's the hack for that, which is current company box. You can answer this liberally. It doesn't have to be where you're at currently. I've seen previous Titmousers that have relevant work experience that are just like NA, leave it blank, or say unemployed. And that's awful because what you could do is say previously Titmouse, or you can say CCS graduate, or you can say internet Nickelodeon, whatever, right? If you have animation relevant experience, you should put that in current company. It can be 1 to 3. What that means is when I get a pile of applications, like let's say 100 applications, and I only have until in 2 hours to find people to forward it to my producers, I'm probably going to go looking at the people with relevant experience, like, oh, this person worked at Nickelodeon, let me open that application. This person worked at, you know, SIOP, let me open that application. So if you have it, relevant stuff, please put it in current company. Like even if you're like working at Starbucks right now, but you've freelanced for XYZ, use the animation relevant over the literally current company. All right, LinkedIn, use it, please use it. There's gonna be a lot of recruiters trying to find people and they're gonna be using LinkedIn because they don't know where else to go. You wanna use LinkedIn in 2 different ways, social media like Twitter and the resume recruiter thingy. So social media is posting new work, portfolio updates, studies and practices, hashtagging all that so that it's showing up and searchable. Resume is keeping your resume updated and detailed in the right ways, making sure your website and information and email is there. A lot of people don't realize that there's a special place to update your email. So where you want to go is this pencil tool. Then go down to contact information and update your email and website there. When I'm using this special tool called LinkedIn Recruiter, I don't see your full profile and I don't see anything in your featured posts that you might want us to see. What I see is your about page and, you know, your website and email link. So making sure you update that. This is what it looks like. So if you've updated your email in that right place, it'll show up here. Bio is actually a great place to include your website and email just in case. So that's something to keep in mind. Put it at the top, put it at the top. All right, and then when you're talking about your resume experience, these two are good examples of how you wanna label your title. And these two are not good examples. So when I'm searching for, let's say a 2D animator, I'm going to search 2D animator. If you were a 2D animator, but you were a freelance artist, you know, and you are only titling yourself as freelance artist, you're not going to show up. And if you are a designer and you're only calling yourself a designer, I'm not going to be searching designer because what searching designer gets me is graphic design, motion designer, a lot of things. So I'm searching prop design, background design, character design. So making sure that you're titling your experience with the right things so that when I'm searching, you show up. And then it's also nice to like include any kind of information, you know, what you did. So like, instead of saying freelance artist and you storyboarded, you can say storyboard and character designed or character design artist. And then just say like, this was a freelance gig, you know? All right. And then, yeah, if you don't include website, this is what happens in LinkedIn Recruiter versus if you do. All right. The social media aspect of it, let's talk about that. Chase was somebody that worked with Titmouse. He was on our radar to hire for Beavis and Butthead. Our producer got very busy because he was hiring for like 30 roles. He forgot to reach out to Chase. Chase posted this turntable he did for fun on LinkedIn. It popped up on my feed and I was like, oh, did we hire Chase? I don't see him in our employee banks. And then that's how we got Chase back on. So making sure that you're sharing work. If for whatever reason you hear, you know, like, oh, they're hiring for XYZ show, you know, maybe you, on top of applying, if you really want that job, you could do a little personal project and tag it so that it shows up in the relevant place. And it could, you know, it could or could not get you the job. You never know, but some things to think about. All right, figuring out your goals. Make sure that you do figure out your goals. You don't have to know exactly what you want to do. You can say, yeah, I'm not sure yet, and that's fine, but showcase the thing that you're strongest at. I personally, I went to school for 3D animation. I had an internship at Pixar. I graduated, and shortly after graduating and working in the freelance industry, I realized I don't like 3D. I don't like the software and the technical challenges that I have to face in 3D. I'm like, crap. Okay, let's pivot. Let's change and update my portfolio. Got rid of the 3D stuff. I mean, it's in a tab, but it's not the front page. Put up relevant stuff for 2D design. I hustled and worked on a passion project with very, very low pay, but it was with like professionals. It was with a professional director and a professional animator, and that inevitably snowballed and led to like that director was too busy later down the road, recommended me for a directing gig, landed my first directing credit. Somebody else at another studio saw that project that I worked on. I was like, oh, work for me. I have a personal project I'm doing. Hired me, got my first art directing credit. So, you know, thinking about like, if you're going to change, pivot quickly, get that relevant experience and work in there, and, you know, rebrand, remarket yourself as something else. Breaking in is hard. It can take anywhere from 6 months to 1.5 years to 3 years to break in. I've heard from successful art directors at Cartoon Network that said it took them like 5 years and they weren't getting work, right? So it is hard. My recommendations there is update your portfolio every 3 to 6 months with at least one high quality project. If your portfolio is not getting it in 6 months or in a year, something needs to change, right? So don't keep applying with the same thing. Maybe broaden, like, okay, character design's not working out. Let's do some prop designs, right? Like broaden to relevant groups, right? I'm not saying like you got to learn everything because it's hard to learn everything and be good at everything. And then follow up with your contacts when you have significant updates to show, as Drew did, every 3 to 6 months. If you hear back from recruiters or producers, like, this is great, not right now, it's not the right time, follow up with those people. And if you've done a test for a studio and you haven't heard back, just follow up, because it might be that, you know, they don't want you and they didn't have time to let you know, which is unfortunate. Follow up at least once, because we have situations where like, oh, this fell between the cracks, we didn't realize, or somebody sent a test back on a weekend. And it was like late at night, I opened it accidentally. And then by Monday I had like 30 new emails to get and I forgot about that test. So always follow up at least once. If they don't say anything after that, maybe move on, but yeah. And then the wise words of Undertaker, the toes you step on your way to the top are connected to the asses you're going to have to kiss on the way back down. And that's just to say, no matter how high up you get there, whether you're an art director or a director, how you treat other people can affect your ability to get hired in the future. And yeah, I mean, we've definitely, the people that you're going to school with, that you might be helping on homework assignments, or, you know, just being there for, they could be the reasons that you're going to get a, you know, job later down the line. Like, I've worked with interns back in Nathan Love. Now I'm a recruiter at Titmouse, and I've hired people because of how they performed back in Nathan Love times, right? So just be nice. And do your best. And no matter what you get hired for, do your best, because even if you get hired for a really shitty, boring job, if you don't do well on that, why would people hire you on cool, fun jobs? Yeah. Connect with us. titmouse.net/careers is where we post our jobs. Sometimes I also post quick little ones on Twitter or LinkedIn. Hope that was helpful. That was a lot of information.
That was amazing, Ellen. Thank you so much.
Yes, you're welcome.
Thank you, Ellen. That was great. We really appreciate your time today and just such useful information for all of our students. So thank you. And we'll definitely share this recording with the students that couldn't make it today. Mm-hmm. A couple of things. I think, unfortunately, we've kind of run out of time, so there isn't an opportunity for Q&A today. However, if students have questions, they want to send it to me, I can try to get them over to Ellen, and hopefully we can answer some additional questions, or to Betsy as well. And we will also be putting a link in the chat right now with a 2-minute survey about today's presentation, just to get your feedback and learn more about what you'd like to see in the future. So please, if you have time, fill that out. But again, Ellen, thank you so much for joining us today and for being a supporter of CCS and our students. Yeah. We appreciate it. And we look forward to continuing to work with you and hopefully get some CCS students over to Titmouse. So thank you. And we will conclude for today. There are some students that will be doing portfolio reviews. So Ellen, if you could hang tight, we will conclude this part of the presentation and then get started with that in just a moment.
Yep.
Thank you, everybody. Great.